How to thought construct a transcendental structure. First, take all of the known bricks, words, and other building materials and put them together in ways never tried before. Then tear it all down and invent for yourself all new materials and construction techniques. A knight whose castle is not original runs twin risk. One is that it will collapse. The other is that it won't. The psychologist visit an aerobatic show and witness this definition. Man's personality, the hot air in a hot air balloon. Once you realize that the concepts of logic and sanity are totally irrelevant to the workings of civilization, you can then allow all of the various new and upcoming games to begin and to continue without you working up a useless sweat thereover. The Boulevard orator comments on this note. For all of you who still struggle over the question of whether man is controlled by his heredity or his environment, I have this to say. You should have been more careful who you were born to. One possible scenario of how progress was born. One prince said to another, "Let us stop fighting over sex and raise our goals to higher standards and levels of matters theoretical and metaphysical." "'Tis sound thinking," replied the other. "Let us battle over whether I will take your liberal mistress or your more conservative one." A father and son linoleum team, while redoing the hallway in the philosophy department at City College, overheard a student ask a professor, "Would being a fatalist be helpful?" And later at lunch, the lad inquired of his dad, "Tell me, sir, would being a fatalist be helpful?" And the older one replied, "The question offers some promise, but as you ponder it for yourself, focus your attention not on what would constitute a fatalist, but rather what would, under the conditions of being one, constitute helpful." A zookeeper pondered one morning as he made his rounds. There should be a level of domestication possible for beasts beyond that of them merely tolerating captivity. And after walking a few steps more, it struck him. Ah! 'Twould be to get them to question the propriety of being the beast that they are. And ergo onward thusly. A man who does not think is not yet a man. And a man who does not think more than he does now is not one either. A mental parking tip. The cop told the motorist, "You shouldn't let your car just sit there idling." And now the story of the five bears. One guy reversed the usual process and began thinking at night and dreaming during the day. The ordinary continually call upon one another to explain by what right they take up space on this planet. While off together on a rhetorical trip, a father told his son, as he baited his line, "Wherever you would feel inclined to use the term naturalness, say instead mere naturalness." "I think I've got one." For you students angling for a better grade in Waltonian physics, it might be helpful to know that originally, in the above, it said, "whenever you feel so inclined," not "wherever." And then, as always, accelerate those particle ponderings regarding the curious structure of a binary-driven reality being perceived by a trinary-capable consciousness. Perhaps the actual difference between the old man's noted distinction twixt naturalness and mere naturalness was the same. The distinction the old man was trying to draw between naturalness and mere naturalness was the same as that between being merely human and being man. Send that to the rewrite department. Neurology as theology or vice versa. A deitist can never overcome demons nor understand gods of a dual nature. The figure in the hood told the dentist, "You may pull my wisdom tooth, but only if you promise to pull them all." And comes this letter. "I have been watching you for a long time and now find inconsistencies in what you say. My brother, who's watched you just as long, says that what I'm seeing are not actual inconsistencies. Our mother says we're both flaky as dandruff even watching you in the first place. Yours, etc." Definition: man. Life talking about itself. And now another tale from M.F. Goose. A man named Frank, while on a spree, stopped in a bank to take a pee. The brothers Grimm got so upset, they began to claim our name is pronounced Grime. Grime, damn it. More ABCs. There is no civilization save the population of the civilized. The turf upon which man's milder and wilder parts waged the sport of civilization was the original inspiration for the modern term regarding an unlevel playing field. Man's domestication, put in literary terms via definitions, erotic. One's individual personality, the little death. Civilization, the big one. The great cosmic neural warfare projected onto its proper expanded scale, which is so gigantic as to never be seen and seldom even suspected. That was the title. All of the battle commanders at the superatomic level know that any prisoner will turn traitor if you can just get him to talk long enough. Just kind of for fun, the god of this one reality, whenever the creatures would do something cute, would say, "Ah, how semi-sweet." They later named a town in Pennsylvania after him. One day in the busy mind of a knight, the thought struck, if there is a point to all this, then there's no point to it. In the grand machinery of your wondrous intellects, if the grand machinery of your wondrous intellect still runs only on AC current, then you're mentally still a child. A viewer writes, "Would you touch again on the matter of thought being local and consciousness universal?" Okay, and how about a few new geographical twists? Consciousness, your city. Thought, your neighborhood. Consciousness, your country. Thought, your city. Consciousness, your continent. Thought, your country. And thought as the pleasant art of map reading, with consciousness as the infinite journey itself. The king of one seminal kingdom looked out from his royal box onto the great Olympic sporting games and said to his queen, "Ah, 'tis good, the literature of the body." The expansion of comprehension. Only the civilized blame other people. Only the civilized think of blame. There was once an insurance operation whose inner office name for policyholders who never filed claims was sleepers. As in patients who lay quietly in their beds or the dead who rest peacefully in their graves. They, on the other hand, referred to clients who did file claims and thus cost the company money as tossers. As in those who would roll about, tug on their covers, and generally disturb the peace and tranquility. In subsequent years, this outstanding institution became so successful that they changed its name from insurance to religion. One guy seems to have one part of one thing figured out. He says that just before you go to bed, if you'll eat some food you've never heard of before, you'll have dreams you can't begin to understand. One instructor at the Knights War College was recently addressing the class. "The mightiest weapon yet devised by man is the atomic bomb. I'm sorry, the atomic mind. No, wait, consciousness. How life works, with or without your help." In the feverish midst of trying to get something fixed, It suddenly all fell into place, and the man said to himself, "Well, by God, I believe you did it. No thanks to you." Question: who but the densest of weevils would criticize the cotton crop? Answer: ever hear the word man? And 447 man viewers got together and sent this response: "You think you're cute, don't you?" Another new intelligence time fairy tale. There was once a little boat who sailed the mighty seas of people. And for many years, everything went all right. But then one day he sprang a leak. And as his hull began to furiously fill with humans, he said to himself, "Steady now, don't panic. Just keep reminding yourself that on this surface, at this level, that which is serious is only so long as you take it so." And next time we'll be taking a closer look at the story of Cinderella shoots herself in the foot, then in yours, and God knows where it goes after that. More psychology taken from the classroom and drawn and quintetted. The unconscious mind. Man's conscious mind attempting to rush about and holler, "What's going on around here anyway?" Since the dawn of man, more people have not understood than have. On the great celebration day, the goddess appeared in the temple doorway and said to the people, "The unexamined life is not worth living." And a fellow in the crowd shouted back, "You don't know mine." The reporter's first question to the great philosopher was, "What would you do if you were in a coma?" The natural flicking out of the fire of the hormonal fuse is like death's soothing, if not psychopathic, mortician, coom, casket salesman. Errata. The above statement should have read, never mind, leave it at that. An all-weather, all-encompassing definition. Criticism. The kicking of helpless children. Now go off and hang your head for a while. Those who badmouth dreams have yet to awaken from theirs. How life keeps man civilized and in line in spite of himself. If you act like you care, you care. As his hunger for new consciousness continued to stalk his old thinking, one man gave to this desire this guiding rhyme. "Circle like a hawk, but hold back the talk. Strong as a bear, but don't ever stare. Survey all the land, but as you map out man, remember that. Here is always there, and yesterday, though present, always in decay." A man's mental condition would not remain so confined that he'd not believe that all prisons exist in a specific place at an exact time. Which is why the new is always a form of freedom, no matter how lowly, no matter how slight. One man's watchword regarding the protection of intellectual assets. Those who ain't got much always want what others have so they can debase it and make it worth no more than what little they do possess. The reason that knights become knights and warriors warriors is simply because they know that no one else is going to protect them where it counts. Rather than accept his combined degree in psychology, theology, and philosophy, this one man took himself into a woods behind the university and demanded of himself reflections on the following question. Why is it that sane men find no fault with the natural workings of the body, even in its grossest forms, and yet feel the need to criticize each and every little operation within the domain of their own mentally contrived one? The peoples on another world hold to this legend. Only the hoop snake lives and thrives the sight of whose own ass it finds repelling. From his study position in the floor, a boy looked up at his father and said, "What is the symbolic message in all of the many stories of a hero's death and resurrection?" And the elder replied, "Ah, I see you're reading those comic books again." And they both laughed that peculiar laugh that they do whenever the old man referred to humor in that peculiar way that he does. Twin definitions. Fear, the mother of all literature. The unexpected unevenness of the civil playing field, the other mother of all lit. Man-made aircraft require rocket engines to compensate for them not having consciousness. After a particular pithy flash of new understanding, one man said to himself, "By God, but at times you are quite impressive," and replied, "Why, yes, you are." Then said, "But I was talking to you," and replied, "I know, that's what I just said." Then he took the occasion to further reflect on the damn near endlessness of infinity and the unusual possibilities extant in non-linear systems. On the matter of consciousness and loyalty, the alert have but one allegiance, and since they know what it is, we don't have to go into it here. And now a medical alert. Watch out! A certain man has approached the president of City College with a suggestion that they open a new department of understanding. Both the heads of philosophy and theology say, over their dead bodies. Based now on your own understanding, ask yourself, should this sort of activity be thought of as an experience, or an adventure, that is, a one-shot deal, or an ongoing deal? Our sweat-saving academics for the day. The only way to understand history is as a metaphor. As regards that viewer's early interest in the distinction between thought and consciousness, this take on it could also be added. While thought is like an artifact of your local talent, consciousness is like the universal creative impulse. The realized mind would be filled with all knowledge, realized consciousness with all possibilities. If we may and if we might, some of what we were talking about last time tied to some of what we're talking about this time. Or if you prefer, some of what we're talking about tonight tied to some of what we're talking about last time. Part of how civilization, everything that is beyond, everything that transcends the level of biosurvival needs for man, how it invents itself. I know that man apparently invents it, but you've got to have a head bigger. Fill it in, make up your own simile. You've got to have a head bigger than bum, 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 bum. That was good. So you still be concerned that individual men are inventing civilization? You can say that you want to. That's the same as saying, well, algebra does exist. Yes, it does. But if that's the extent of your knowledge of mathematics, then you know, you're going to have a career as small as a... Bum, 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 bum. Fill that one in. That you can look at the individual actors of individuals, of individual people as playing some part in inventing civilization, but then you must see. All right, I'll put it to you this way. This will be easier to see. Imagine civilization, and now imagine if there are no humans on this planet. Civilization will go right on. Okay. Don't slow down for that one, all right? Civilization continues to, it must invent itself, and is tied to what I was trying to bring your attention to again as to people hearing some of the ideas from this kind of activity throughout history and thinking very often that, wait, and being able to dismiss it also by saying, well, you're just saying that life is just tied up and is almost, you know, predestined, that we're all victims of fate and there's nothing can be done. We closed out last time, if you recall, me trying to get you to stick your awareness in that real dangerous crack. It's a lot worse than the shifting plates out there around Los Angeles. But wherein everyone does what they have to do. It's just that the more alert do not comment on it. That is, they're to the questions and problems of man's invented world, civilization. There are no correct or incorrect answers or solutions until it's brought up. That is, until you ask about it, until you comment on it. It is a kind of safety feature wherein ordinary people, if they ask it, it's their own reclassification of themselves, reestablishment of their classification that they are where they belong. Because if you believe that there's got to be a right or wrong answer, a correct or incorrect answer, that there's got to be some kind of solution, or taking it down to the absolute, if you follow it, a threshold level of human intelligence vis-a-vis man's life, that is them asking, wait a minute, are we free? Can we change things? Can I change myself? Can man change life? Or are we locked into some sort of just fatalistic reality and just things are going on by themselves? There's no answer to that. And it's easy enough, I guess, for me to say that, or people say it in the past, and it'd be also twice as easy. And on the surface, twice as intelligent for ordinary people to go, well, what kind of crap is that? I ask you a simple question. It was a simple answer. Every time you question at the ordinary level, every time you ask the kind of questions that everyone else thinks are decent questions, you have just simply reestablished you living in an intellectual ghetto. This is, again, although it's not the only reason, a kind of safety catch on the gun of civilization so that it will not shoot itself, or so that men can't play around with guns and accidentally shoot it, I'll put it that way. It's ordinary people, the ordinary mind, it's not people, it's the ordinary mind, cannot ask questions, cannot even entertain questions, can't even come up with them, that are outside whatever the growing contemporary body of cliched thought is. At times, whether it be now or times in the past or times in the future, this kind of activity, here and there, you could stick your ear in and listen to it, and it sounds anachronistic, which, if you recall, does not necessarily mean just behind the times. What it means is it's out of time. I know anachronistic, by connotation, seems to be used as being archaic, but it's not. It is simply that what you hear or what's going on seems to be outside of its normal, expected place and time. This sort of activity, when it's in somebody, I don't mean just me and you doing it, but when it's inside of somebody's own consciousness, you can't ask the questions everybody else asks. And yet the very thing that would seem to be the mapping of metaphysical, transcendental activity is always, in fact, they insist on it. It seems to have almost blood, sweat, beatific, blood and sweat dripping off this kind of leaves, this ivy, this kind of fungus growing on certain old questions. That is, they're so ancient they're considered to be, in some way, down there sacred, and not necessarily in just a specific religious sense. That is, the same damned old questions forever and ever. If you are personally dealing with what seem to be questions and problems, that even though your mind may say, well, these are outside the mainstream, in other words, I am not worrying like my friends are, the people I normally hang around with, they're worried about how to refinance their home, how to get another car, how to save up and get a hair transplant or their nose straightened out. No. I worry about, more than that, I think about, is there a God? I mean, for instance, well, that's just considered a historical one. If you're asking questions that have already been asked, all it is a reinforcement of where you live. All it is a kind of suicide. All it is a kind of continual stabilization of your own limitation. Again, I'll say this for a point. We're not talking about me, but I can say, boy, it's easy to say. And people, yeah. But all you got to do is sit around. We'll play this one again. Right now, we can take a couple of seconds. And it takes somebody extremely non-mainstream to be able to even do this. For me to say, all right, do you realize the difficulty right now if I said, try and just think of an idea of some type that nobody's ever thought of or that you've never heard of. Try and think of a question. What if you suddenly, let's play this, that you pulled a thorn out of my paw and I could call up a genie and gave you a wish. And you can ask one question. And this, you know, I got this genie here on call and he will answer any question. But it's got to be an extraordinary question. It can't be how can you, you know, what's going to be the number tomorrow in the lotto. It's got to be some metagnostic, metaphysical question and he will answer it. Except, it can't be some answer, question he's heard before. Now, right now, then think. Is there something you could come up with? Can you think of anything out of the ordinary? This is not a rhetorical or pseudo-psychological game. It is a fact. And again, we're playing with an aerial. I keep saying a crack because there's no great name for it. It's right between collective reality and something else. It's right between sanity, which is collective reality, and something else. Because if normally, if it was a challenge or we made it like a parlor game, can you think of some idea, can you think of some question that you have never heard anyone ask about the nature of life? And it was suddenly like, you win a little prize here. Everybody's at the party. At least you're just trying to win and do good. And they say, all right, it's a real good game. All you got to do, you got 10 seconds. Think of some question. If we had like the world's greatest mystic here, if we had God himself or Buddha or anybody, whatever the game went, and you could ask one question, but it's got to be a question about the nature of life, the nature of existence, that no one's ever asked the exact question, and you got 10 seconds. Could you do it? May I suggest to you that under almost any circumstances, all you would come up with, if you really gave it a shot, would be something that would verge past that little crack that would sound insane. In other words, you would have to just about make up, assuming you were that quick on your mental feet, you'd have to just about make up a non sequitur. Like, is life actually like a bowl of rancid oatmeal? That's all you could do. Is life actually like an elephant flying backwards? In other words, something that, the sentence may have made sense, but Jesus, what the hell does that mean? And that's about the best you could do. I would suggest one more time that that is part of the great intrigue at a very low level with alcohol and then into all other drugs and into some forms of changing the brain chemistry without apparent intake of external chemicals. Such you do with sleep deprivation or fasting, extraordinary mental physical activity, that you do something that will actually change the brain chemistry temporarily. And it makes what amounts to new connections. And that is, at a very low level, even with pot, cocaine, even alcohol, and sometimes, that you can almost think things, look at things, listen to something somebody said, have an idea that you would have never had, that there was a slightly different connection that you just suddenly think, well, I would have never, somebody, you hear somebody talking, two people talking maybe, and suddenly you have a thought that's right between any sense of sane reality, between these two people, they're discussing the nature of politics or something, and suddenly you think something that's not simply a non sequitur, it's not just foolishness. In fact, you know what it is because you won't even say it. You know that it's outside the realm that anybody could hear. That's when you're not too stoned or too drunk. But it is like a low-level mystical experience. Or taken further, that is one fair description, verbal description of the great transcendental experiences. It's simply that you're making neural connections. Neural connections are made in you, if we're going to be a little more truthful, which are not normally extant, which are not normally available. And it's not something a man can simply pull upon. It's not something a man suddenly says, well, I'll think differently. Oh, God, but you could. You know, if that was possible, we'd all be in business. We'd be on 130,000 stations. or else 130,000 stations would be on us here. Which is back to, if you'd like another little sidestep, back to even when they don't know what they're talking about any longer, of the mystical tradition, schools, and et cetera, that will right up front say, well, now you can come over here and we'll be delighted to let you stay here in this monastery. You can sit here with the rest of us and freeze your butt off and go without food and meditate and be quiet. And hey, every now and then, you know, like every 100 years or so, somebody here that goes, pow! We know it. In fact, one of the old guys here, go see Monk so-and-so. He was here back about 1912 when the last guy did it. And you ask him, say, did a guy here really happen? And if you got any sympathy, any symbolic, symbiotic vibrations with such as that, the guy would just turn and look at you. And you know that it means yes. He didn't have to say anything. You just say, did one of the monks here, did one of the guys doing the stuff you do, did they tell me the truth? Somebody in the last 100 years, in your lifetime, somebody did it? And he goes, I'm just doing my best imitation. What? He goes, oop, and you look. And he didn't even say it was him. And now he is 90 years old. He's been sitting there for 70 of the years, but that one time's enough. The point is, they will admit, again, regardless that they understand it, it's in the places that have a longer tradition of this, normally referred to as the East. You mean Savannah? No. With a greater tradition of it, a greater history of it, it has become almost part of the tradition to admit up front to would-be students and any public statements they make that this kind of activity is certainly in line. It has certainly been proven in some way. It is, of course, normally have the written word of some great past master of a Zarathustra or the Butter King or Buddha or Confucius. They rely, at any rate, that these kind of methods are what a man should be doing. Well, they are based upon something because that's why they're remembered. Whatever, they're all more or less, variations of the same thing of trying to quiet the mind, trying not to be carried away by the desires of the body and all that, and trying not to get in fights and hurt yourself and do things that are self-destructive. So that strikes people as correct, but they say, they will admit, part of their own canons is you can't guarantee it, you can't predict it. It's like those upon whom the Buddha would smile, he smiles. Or those, when the universe wants to talk, it talks. Or put a little more correctly, sometimes it happens, most of the time it doesn't. But what are you going to do? You can go ride a bus and stay home or come here with us and try it. And it does happen sometimes, except you can't predict it. That if the truth be known, which is of no importance, but I'll go ahead and say if the truth be known, the guy that my imaginary figure back in 1910 that did go, pow! We asked them, say, well, the people here then that had been doing, they're more faithful in their practice and the sitting and the fasting than he was. Is there any accounting? I mean, can you look back now and think, well, I knew it'd be him. In fact, you were here like 50 years when he got here. How long was he here before it happened? And he goes, you go 2 years? And he goes, 2 months? 2 weeks? Those trying to feed this particular hunger. Those who would like to have some extraordinary idea of what's going on, just for their own individual, private, perverse pleasure. I never put it that way. Because once you do, it is private and perverse because you can't brag about it. It's like, you can make the great mystical adventure and all that, you can make it sound to be a lofty, some kind of cosmic, well, in fact, they love to say mystical, metaphysical. I keep throwing, repeating their same words. But it sounds like something great and lofty, but I would not discount, if you will take a humble suggestion from this humble servant, I would not fail to suggest to you that part of the real pleasure cannot be said not to be simply an individual pleasure that, well, goddamn, that is it. Now you see how it all, you see what's going on. And nobody else did up until now. Nobody else could tell you. Nobody else saw it. The smartest people you ever knew, people that when you were younger you thought impressive. I know it sounds crude. It's not quite that crude. It's a lot cruder. But in a cosmic sense. It's a kind of perverse place. God damn. And you realize that probably nobody else around really understands. Well, God damn. So do not discount that kind of private, perverse pleasure. But it cannot be, ordinarily, it cannot be predicted. But it can be negatively predicted. That is, it can be said what will keep you from doing anything. And the main thing that will keep you from doing anything is commenting upon the inevitable. That is, that everybody's got to do what they've got to do. But the more alert, someone who may have some chance of being able to scratch, to be able to feed, to be able to have this perverse private pleasure. Super perverse private pleasure. And I'm saying perverse with not just one set of inverted commas, but three outside of it. It's quoting itself after having quoted itself. Is that kind of perverse pleasure? Very private. Some of the ways that you can negatively predict that it will not happen is the continual reinforcement of what you think, which is mental staring. Which brings into, if you want to play this little dance one more time in a certain, slightly different way. I was just mentioning the great traditions, which, at least in the part of the world that they call Jacksonville, no, the East. The Outer Banks? Not the East, with a capital E. The East. Is the attempt to quiet the mind by sitting, by meditating, and by things that would seem to physically, hormonally, as I've been putting, but would seem to physically contribute there too. Fasting. Sleep deprivation. Fooling around with the biosurvival level, not enough to hurt yourself. But doing things that then, as always, at the roots always, affect the limbs and the what's going up there with the birds and the squirrels and the tree up here. Yeah. Hope no one takes offense at that kind of allegory related to your mental activity. But I didn't say anything about nuts. I said squirrels and birds and limbs a little white growths on them. But the traditional practices has been to calm the mind, etc. And that would seem to be. But how would then you account for instance? It's always been hanging around, but you have seen a real burst of activity in most of your people's lifetime of the Eastern martial arts being considered as a form of metaphysical practice, or can be, or the hint that somewhere it was, even, you know, cheap knockoff films from the great studio of Run Run Shaw, or the Kung Fus and stuff, the stuff on TV, things that, you know, they even make the inference, all these Kung Fu movies. I know that they make the inference, and it doesn't take much. I don't mean some kind of conspiracy, but it doesn't take much that it seems to be no more than a Hollywood-type Western put in a different setting. You know, good guys, bad guys, it's all black and white, good and evil, all kinds of blood and, you know, hitting and kicking and all that. But there is this inference that just seems to be accepted by people where they go to the movie for that reason, that within that somewhere was some purpose far beyond learning how to kick some other guy in the gonads and get by with it. So what is it? And why is it that there's been so many stories that we move into the East of the knights, holy wars? You know, even digging it back up and using terms like knights and warriors. What is it about? But back to the apparent martial arts, which would seem to be something completely different if we imagine in some imaginary spot in the eastern part of the world, and also in the eastern part of your consciousness, if you're getting that good. So we're not really talking about China or Japan. We're talking about China or Japan and you, Bunky. That there it is, and right outside of Kyoto is this little monastery, and people sitting there, motionless, trying to hold their eyes, just lids half closed, and just staring, trying to control everything. And then, 20 meters down the street, you've got people jumping, leaping around, involved in all forms of martial arts. The inference with the martial arts, and I'll go ahead and say it, there have been ways that they were attempting to use that as a kind of practice. But in what way? All right, I'll answer it for you. It's to not stare. It's to continually be on guard, which makes it easy to describe and will attract a different kind of persona than someone who would be attracted to, you can come join us and you can sit here. We don't talk. We don't allow women. We don't you got to work a little bit. Once a week, you got to clean the toilets. You know, but hell, you'd have done that if we joined the army. Of course, it pays a little bit better. But there are people who would be attracted to, come here, we're behind closed walls, we don't talk, we move very slowly, even when we get up and go to eat. Everything's slow. Then there are people that the idea of some kind of more active practice of the warrior. The thing some of you have heard me point out before, and even I throw in periodically, if you recall, about kind of omni, non-static consciousness, that rather than a flashlight, if you looked at one's mental awareness as being a flashlight, you normally look around, which serves you quite well. It served everybody from Galileo to Pancho Pilate to Copernicus to everyone else. It's to turn your eyes, your mental attention on something. It's like being one single-minded artist, scientist, thinkers, writers. But rather than it being that, it would be like a searchlight, like a lighthouse instead of a flashlight. Now, for civilized purposes, you almost have to use a flashlight approach. That is, you have to be single-minded. It's known as concentration. It's even seen as being salubrious to one's career, to the advancement of technology, that a man can stand around, Dr. So-and-so at MIT, working on some problem. He can go out, you know, kind of wander off into the lunchroom and stand there and drink coffee and, you know, put Jell-O in his coffee and look off, and people bump into him, and him standing in the midst of all this, and he's still working on this formula. In some way, almost, you know, staggers back to his lab, you know, and only sprains himself an ankle today rather than break a foot like he does some. But he's able to do all this. It's like a single-mindedness. Now, I'm exaggerating, of course, but that is, all of you know that. We don't have to make fun of some imaginary figure in the great Northeast. You do it yourself. It's like sit around, you can be worried about or just thinking about something or doing nothing, but apparently even have a project in mind that you're trying to think of something, trying to figure out how to do something, trying to write a new song, trying to do something. And it's like a single-mindedness. That is, as I said, it is almost de rigueur for the overall movement of civilization, of the collective advancement of mankind in the technical external sense. And if you were doing some part of it, whatever part you were playing at that time is no great importance. It gets down to this, when it gets to your individual level and you stay single-minded, that you keep replaying the song, replaying the record. You know, when your girlfriend left you, when your boyfriend left you, when somebody cheated you, their final words about, hey, you can trust me. Hey, you can trust me. And it's been going on, now you've been playing that song. Or whatever it is, or, you know, life doesn't love me. Nobody, whatever the hell it is. It is a single-mindedness. It is a staring. It is a kind of negative meditation that rather than sit there, you may be standing, walking around like somebody, but internally, you're sitting there in one spot thinking the same damn thing over and over and over and over. What is not actually supportive to an ordinary person's mind, which from another view, now we'll take their position, is neither here nor there because they can't do it anyway. But it would not be necessarily conducive to the ordinary advancement of collective civilization if everyone was walking around with a kind of warrior attitude. That if your consciousness was, you were forcing it to stay always on the alert. No reason. Now you got to remember that now, in case we got children here. It's not that you imagine, all right, I'm going to become a metaphysical warrior and I'll always be on guard for enemies. I've already tried to cover that a few days ago to try to lead you up to it. Remember, that even the great stories, the knights go out and all the things they have to overcome to finish the mystical quest. What do they have to overcome? Dragons! Dragons don't exist! I thought everybody knew that. So when you're thinking about the warrior, it's not like these guys like, I'll become my own secret spiritual warrior and I'll always be alert. Always alert for the enemy. That's good, except people that believe that, they don't know where the opposition is anyway. But it is a kind of active meditation to do it yourself. Once you get past the point, as a night tonight pointed out, he said, hey, the thought struck him, if there is a point to all this, then there's no point to it. Which would be, if you're going to take upon yourself, which is a very good, highly recommended method to try and stay outside the grip of ordinary reality, neurally speaking, individually speaking, is that you stay constantly alert. Constantly, but you've got to get past any idea, especially guys, that you're still a 7-year-old kid and you think, well, I'll grow up to be Bruce Lee or whoever, and I'll always be. Because I know we're all surrounded by bad guys. You know, when you're 7, you think you're surrounded by bad guys. If you're now 27 or 37 and you got any intellectual maturity, you know you're surrounded by bad guys, but you don't have to leave your room to find them. That is bad guys in the sense of, people are doing me no good. But there is a kind, and literally, some of you have already heard me mention this, but I'll do it again. Literally, it is a quite valid method. It's a kind of active other side of meditation, etc., a kind of focusing of the mind, a non-focusing of the mind. Is that it's easily put, is never stare, which I am going to suggest to you is the normally unnoted, unrecognized basic attraction and belief, even unstated belief, tacit assumption that behind martial arts, especially from the East, is some sort of transcendental, some sort of metaphysical, some sort of secret, some kind of other level of activity. I don't know what it is, but surely these people didn't spend all their life just so that they could learn to do this, because you could learn to actually whip somebody's ass like that, 6 months, a year if you're real dumb and clumsy. But they're obviously doing something else because they keep doing the same things, they keep going through the same practices, and they don't actually fight. They even say the point is not to get in a fight, that in fact you kind of screwed up if you actually get out and have to use this physically. An ordinary person will think, good God, they're as crazy as he is. What kind of crap's that? It is the point that you are continually alert, that you are continually struggling against the civilizing effect, or the civil effect on the mind, that is to narrow it. It would be literally never to stare. It's not to show off, it's not letting anybody know it, but even by yourself. That here is a game, I've already, since I warned you, that it's not a 7-year-old boy's believing that they're going to grow up to be the Lone Ranger or Zorro or Batman and always, but literally just even by yourself, to get up in the morning. And, of course, first you've got to notice the normal state that people stay in mentally, that you wake up, and it's not just the weariness of the night's sleep and the little sleep fairy still in your eyes, but you wake up. And you can go up, you can turn off the alarm, you reach over there and do it without even looking. I know this is an attack. Part of this is the efficiency of man. But there you can wake up, just open one eye a little bit, you realize you hear the noise, you can reach over there and hit the alarm without knocking it over, a little clock over there, and you can reach right over and hit the one little button and go, ding. You can get up, kind of pull the covers or have you straighten it up, and you can get your foot out of bed. And you can, almost as a zombie, once you become aware of it. And it's the natural state of man, even though it's in the written, which is the third-hand vomit of transcendental mystical experience. Well, it is. It's the leftovers. But in the written literature, they constantly, it is made as an attack. That man is a zombie, which you're back now, remember this, that everybody does what they have to do. But the more alert, don't comment it. It's everybody else that comments on it. All the way from criticizing themselves to trying to encourage themselves. It doesn't matter what. If you're doing what you have to do and comment on it, you're doing more than you have to do. And that is not in a positive sense, might I add. That you get up, you become aware of, all of you should know this, it sure is easy to forget, and everybody sure does like to forget it. Notice, not because I say so, this is not a Baptist bear, Wednesday night bear meeting to make you feel guilty. You should be able to do it to yourself to realize I have not really sort of come to my best conscious senses in what? Let's see. Well, it was sometime in 1993. And you think, this can't be. I made it this far. I got a raise in pay. I traded cars. You know, I mean, it seems like things have happened. I'm in better shape. But it was in a dream. Which, of course, when you get real good at this, you think, well, maybe the whole last few months have been a dream. But you can get up. You can walk downstairs. You can go in, you can turn on hot water. You can turn on coffee. And apparently be thinking, in fact, perhaps about important things. Like today you have an important presentation at work. You have to go do an interview with a new vice president they've sent in from Akron. It may be the difference between a job and not a job, or a raise in pay. And you're doing all this, and all the time you're walking around. And in a sense, you're not even there. You're there at a minimal level. The kind of not staring, the kind of, I'm suggesting to you, the inverted, the other side of the static practice of meditation is a kind of alert, a kind of walking around meditation wherein you don't stare, wherein, I'm suggesting, is the inner core that people suspect of all the martial art things, is a kind of warrior. One more time, you should know this. It's not some form of insanity, and you're not playing games to impress somebody else, but you treat life as though you are constantly alert, that you got out of bed. And I'm going to go ahead and exaggerate, since I've tried to establish now that you know I'm not exaggerating. I'm exaggerating. So that you know now I'm not serious. I'm serious. No, now that you know it's not really a joke, it's a joke. That you got out of bed, and you got out of bed, and it's like, I'm just being silly. And you got out of bed, entertaining. It's like you got out, you hear the bell and you wake up and you think, the bell. And then you're undercover, you're up here under your nose. And you go, all right. Now I know you're there in the house alone, it's all locked up, and you figure, but you go. You look at the clock and it's your clock. I mean, it could be a bomb over there, and you look. Mash it. The covers, who knows? You look at having carried that far, then there's enough of you who understand the negative side of, insofar if you're trying to do something extraordinary, you don't understand the negative side of living this zombie life, which you can live a zombie life and be the head of a university, be the head of a church, be a philosopher, be successful, be famous. And if none of that works, go into politics. You've got no problem. But the converse of that would be a kind of warrior mentality that literally, it's just a way to force yourself to do it. It would be, in other words, you could say a non-clerical version of the religious ideas that you can find in many offshoots of what seem to be religions that would seem to bleed into the mystical factions of trying to remember the name of God, trying to remember the 10,000 faces of Buddha, trying to remember the breath each and every time of Vishnu. All you're trying to do is jog yourself out of that hypnotized state that there is something true or false going on, there's something right or wrong, there is something very important that I've got to comment on, that is, I've got to think about. It's like a continual slapping yourself around. Like, you little squinty-eyed bastard, snap out of it! And you treat it rather than being involved with, rather than being involved with, it's a waste of energy. You're draining yourself to think, I'm doing something religious. I'm doing something to please the gods. I will always think of God. Which, if you knew how to do that, would be okay. That would be that same kind of thing. But, of course, you knew how to do that. You could think, I will always think of a 60-month car battery. But, I'll leave it to you to decide which might gain you a greater following to say that you have this great new technique to increase your consciousness. And one of them, you tell people, one crowd, you say, what you do is each and every breath, you try and remember the name of God. You try and just picture the name, and you say it quietly to yourself, God. And then you tell the other group, what you do is with each and every breath, you try and think of a 60-month, guarantee you, 60-month car battery. See, people take one of them as having some extrinsic, some metaphysical significance, and the other one seems to be crude and meaningless. Where have I heard that term before? Does the name man strike a bell? Oh, I'm sorry. Ordinary consciousness. Another way to look at it, though, is if you follow, it's devoid, if that was your problem any longer, well, it's stripped of any religious connotations. It's stripped of any specific point. Like the night saying, if there's a point to all this, there's no point to it, which is open to further slipping and sliding. But at any particular time, if you think, well, there's got to be a point right now, then the thing about the warrior mentality, that is of not staring, which is actually better than the warrior mentality, but I was trying to get you to see that there is a kind of historical continuing genetic line, a continuum tied through all this of not staring, but to feel as though I am almost a warrior. Well, getting all carried away. But I've got to stay alert because life itself is a great hypnotizing machine. It's a chicken farm. It's a mink farm, and I be the mink. I be the chicken. Which, those of you who have never been on a farm, real fun is to hypnotize a chicken. Because you can have an IQ just in the low twin numbers, and even you can hypnotize a chicken. Well, if it goes too low, that's an old joke. Wasn't a joke, it's a chicken hypnotize the guy. But even we don't get into that. It's that life will cause you to stare. And the thing about the warrior mentation that has no religious connotations, is not supposed to have any particular point to it, is this: you just play like once you understand it. Because the playing like doesn't help a lot, but once you have your own understanding that everything in life is arranged in a certain way, and it's not supposed to change drastically. And it's certainly not going to change just because of me, just because I holler, wait a minute, this whole thing seems like some kind of dream, and maybe life doesn't really say no. And you go, well, I want out of it. I want something else. I'm sorry, life doesn't have time for that. If anybody's got time for it, it's got to be you. And if you notice, you don't hardly have time for it. You say you do, and then suddenly it's like this, and you go, where'd the time go? And when you meant to do it, it was 7 o'clock this morning, not 7 o'clock tonight. You think, what happened? 12 hours went somewhere. The warrior mentality is to just simply stay alert and do not stare. And all this does is physically remind you, if you know how to do it, and it's not just a psychological gambit, is to keep you from internally staring. It's to keep you from commenting. That you may do what you have to do. Everybody does what they have to do. It is that a more alert man doesn't comment on it. Mm-hmm. And to comment on it requires that you stare, literally. You've got to fall into, alert man, Willis, I mean by that, somebody a little out of the ordinary. So if you're already a little out of the ordinary and trying, conversely, if you do comment on the inevitable, you have lowered yourself back to where you were. You're no longer more alert. Whatever the comment is, what comment's necessary? What comment is pertinent? Here's the closest thing to a pertinent comment. Mm-hmm. Not just alert that when I go out in the garage to get my car, I better watch it. There could be some kind of ninja, spooky devil out there. Yeah, there could be. Yes, that you might look around and suddenly see a tree, a shadow. Of course, all that's foolishness. And suddenly you turn around and you see your boss. So I'm doing, you fall back into a dream, you got in your car, backed out of the driveway without knocking down trees, hedges, without hitting the people parked out in the street. You're now on the expressway doing 75 miles an hour. You are commenting on collective reality. That's your comment. There's not, if you're more alert, you don't have any comment. Not about what you have to do, I'm assuming you had to go to work. Just under general conditions, your life is such that you've got to get up and go to work. What the hell is the comment? It's only children. Really, it's only children. It's only childish consciousness that will comment on the inevitable. Such as saying, oh, I hurt my finger. Is that an important observation? The kid cut his finger and it's bleeding. They go, I hurt my finger. Hey, look out on the expressway. You're surrounded by people in the morning at drive time doing 75 miles an hour to bumper on their way to work looking pissed. You know, and their comment is, I cut my finger. I'm having to do what I have to do. It's like, how come nobody notices? Well, it's because everybody else does. It's because, like, you can ask yourself, what kind of credit do you deserve? What kind of recognition do you deserve for being alive. Well, and of course, suffering, of course. I didn't throw it in, but you know it. But now, as an ordinary man goes, the credit is, you know, what makes me somebody worth knowing, worth mentioning? It's because I am alive. Which is not how they'd say it. We've already been to it. What they're going to say is, because I put up with crap you wouldn't believe. I have problems and personal difficulties that you wouldn't believe, and yet, I'm alive. Well, on the count of three, let's all of us swoon. By the way, you can't swoon and stare. In case you... That was the last one for the night. Of course, the real thing is you can't psychologically suffer and stare. Don't get that on tape. People hate that. They don't hear that crap. You mean you can't have psychological problems if you don't stare? Maybe that isn't what I meant. Maybe I misspoke.